Welcome to our June's conversation with experts, the panel conversation with experts. This month, I wanted to focus on the technician bodies. So I wanted to think about raising awareness of the accounting technicians as professional accountants. I think there is a lack of understanding of really the role that they will play, of the possibilities and the opportunities associated with that. And as a panel, we think about the professional accountancy bodies as a whole and the implication of the education standards. So we're going to hear from two of our technician bodies, as well as the Confederation of Asian and Pacific Accountants. And I thank them all for joining us today. You'll also see there may be a couple of individuals from the Professional Accountancy Organization Development Advisory Group. They're also focusing on the role of the technician in developing PAOs. So I thought it would be a wonderful kind of convergence between the two advisory groups. As always, please feel free to ask any questions. And this is an active group, and some of my most active members are here today, so I'm thankful for that. So without further ado, let me get started. And I'm going to introduce Sumita Shah from CAPA, who's going to talk us through some of the strategy that they think about in terms of the technicians. I know CAPA focuses on more than just technicians, but this has become a real focus of an initiative for them these days. Thanks for joining us today, Sumita.
I'm going to just obviously talk a little bit about CAPA, but I'll give you a little bit of context about CAPA as a regional body. Just before I also do that, let me just also give you a little bit of background about myself, which is very relevant to what I'm going to talk about. And Rob and Gillian know this about me. I myself studied for the accounting technician qualification many years ago. And in fact, I had an email to say I've been a member for 30 years, and that enabled me to go on to do two other professional accountancy qualifications as well. I'll talk a little bit about this later, about the opportunities that I would not have been afforded had I not been able to do the accounting technician qualification. So back to CAPA, we are an IFAC network partner, and we're one of the four regional organisations in the Asia-Pacific region. We are based in KL, and we actually have a very small secretariat. So there's Brian, who's the chief executive, myself, and two other members of staff. So our mission in terms of the work that we do, we contribute to the development of professional accountancy organisations, and I'll come back to this in a few minutes. We are very much about promoting the ethical values and benefits of high quality accounting, reporting and assurance, and that underlines, you know, sort of a lot of the work that we do and the publications that we write about, and we speak out as a voice of the accountancy profession. So we have 30 member PAOs across 22 jurisdictions, and our combined membership of these PAOs is over 2 million. Now, we have written a number of publications. Helen mentioned that, and our role, like I sort of said, we the broader theme of our work is around PAO development, and we tend to focus on topics that we believe are relevant to not just PAOs in our region, but also beyond our region, and, you know, into sort of other areas as well. And a lot of the publications, and certainly the ones I'll be talking about briefly, will demonstrate just, you know, that other PAOs can pick these up. Now, we focus on the public sector, we focus on accounting technician, and we focus on what we call this maturity model. And the maturity model is a support tool for PAOs to think about their own organisational development. And it, what it does is it provides a roadmap for growth and looks at the sort of practices and processes. So PAOs can pick this up and think about their own practice and processes, irrespective of whatever stage of development they are at. As part of the maturity model series, When that was developed, that within the maturity model, there's 16 elements that we talk about. And over the years, we started to pick up some of the elements and developed further guides. So, for example, the CPD guide, the quality assurance for audit, investigation, discipline, governance, and then what I'm going to talk about today, which is the professional qualification. Now, in all of our work, we try not to duplicate what's already out there. Rather, we concentrate on areas that there isn't enough information that, you know, we feel would be relevant. And so in our publications, we have a very much a structure that we use, which has worked throughout when we're developing these guides. And that's really about the why, the what, and the how. So in the professional qualification guide, one of the things that really comes out quite strongly is that a strong professional qualification supports and strengthens and, you know, a strong profession itself. And without a strong profession, the national, the business and, you know, the environment, public sector and civil society are held back from achieving their full potential. So we think it's really important to have this strong PQ. It helps this profession stay and remain strong. And it, in turn, one of our roles is to help build strong economies. In the what section, one of the things we do is talk about that the professional qualification isn't necessarily just the responsibility of the PAO itself. It requires collaboration of different experts, and the relationships with key stakeholders is really important in developing this qualification. And I know that probably Rob will talk about that a little bit later on. So one of the key elements of the PQ guide is about the eight pillars and around those, the different sort of the entry exit routes. And I'll come back, for example, to the entry exit route in a minute. We also, in the PQ guide, think about some, you know, the how is often important to give people examples of approaches that other PAOs are using and some of the components that they might have used in implementing either a new PQ or when they're reforming or, you know, revising their existing one. Underlying what we talk about and in all of our publications, and particularly this one, we, you know, the IFAC requirements, for example, in SMO2 are really important. And so everything we're doing is making sure that we're aligning with what is being talked about globally. And so we do link into IFAC requirements quite a lot. Now, the guide can be used by PAOs to assist in the creation of new qualifications, but also it can be used and you know, picked up by those that have very developed qualifications to benchmark and think about how they can improve their existing qualifications. So it's consistent also with the requirements of the education standards. And really sort of moving on to this topic of accounting technician, this guide can be applied equally to both the professional accountancy qualification, and by that we mean the CPA or the chartered accountants qualification, but also can equally be applied to the accounting technician qualification as well. Now, traditionally, the entry requirements for a professional accountants program, the CPA or the chartered accountant, has been quite stringent and, you know, very specific. It requires, for example, people to have a degree, and therefore it creates a barrier for those who don't have the opportunity to go to university, and then it therefore limits that talent pool of accountants. And I'll, you know, just going back to briefly when I mentioned earlier about how I've got through to where I am today, if I didn't go to university, but if I hadn't done the accounting technician qualification At the time, at the point in my life, at a very young age that I did do it, I wouldn't have been able to continue on to do some of the other qualifications that I'd be able to do. And that really sort of, I suppose, amplifies, you know, that how important this has been for many people who cannot access universities and have degrees. So the AT programme, you know, there might be similar programs, address the, you know, this entry and the, you know, minimizing those barriers. They address this through the flexible entry. So, you know, and it's not even just about school leavers. There are mature students who will also be able to access the accounting technician program. And when you become a qualified AT and, you know, you can choose whether you want to go on to do further studies and you want to go on to become, you know, qualified in a sort of another professional accountancy program. And that might provide having the AT, you might then get exemptions. But also accounting technicians, and many do choose to do this, they don't necessarily want to go on to do further studies, but they can still enter the workforce with a recognised qualification, or use that qualification if they, for example, are a mature student, they can use that qualification to then, you know, be able to get themselves promoted in within their organisation as well. So the qualification ladder really opens up the opportunities to all and widens that access to the profession. So this leads me on to a project that CARPA is working on. Now, our interest in accounting technician dates back many, many years, but our focus in the last 6 to 8 years has been on developing some of the publications that I've highlighted on the slides here. And we can give you the links to those if you get copies of the slides, and the links are already in there. But we've did one publication in 2018 and another follow-up in 2020. Now, moving on from that, then last year we started to think about, well, where do we go from here? So we developed a webinar and invited a number of key players who are working, you know, developing accounting technician qualifications. And really what we wanted to do was explore what more, if anything, could be done to raise the profile of accounting technicians. And before I just move on to talk more about that, there's also, if people have spotted on the IFAC website, there is an article that was published earlier this year in March, written by Brian, who's our chief executive, about the untapped potential of accounting technicians. And he goes into a sort of depth of information there about why the accounting technician cohort is important. So in the July 21 webinar, we reflected on those current issues, the challenges, and then the opportunity for future development of accounting technicians. And at that time, the group as a whole came to a conclusion that led us to this challenge and what we call a goal, to examine and try to succeed in achieving accounting technician recognition. And we're exploring whether this goal is achievable and whether there are any global implications in this. And we're doing this through a series of online roundtables. So we have a task force that's in place, and the task force is exploring a number of matters and looking at you know, six sort of quite distinct areas. What do we mean by recognition when we mention the word, you know, to achieve that accounting technician recognition? So what do we mean by it? We think about the future role of the accounting technician, and where, like the professional accountant, you know, they are constantly evolving and moving forward into the sort of future requirements, that's the same for the accounting technician. And so what might that future look like? We talked about how the AT qualification can be positioned, and, you know, how is it currently positioned and how can it be positioned in the future. We talk about the benefits of a professionalised AT cohort as well, and you know what the benefits are, not just to the profession, but also to wider stakeholders. At the last roundtable, we started to talk about the definition of an accounting technician, because is there a reason why it's not being recognised, and you know, could that be something to do with the definition? So we started to explore that, and coming up next week, we are identifying the key stakeholders that need to be involved in this overall goal of helping to achieve recognition. But we also want to understand what the needs of those stakeholders are and how they can support that overall goal. So the challenge has been for the AT and equivalent role. But first of all, we do believe it's a fundamental part of the accountancy profession, and that's a wider spectrum. It's a fundamental part of the accountancy supply chain. And ATs play an important role in the wider accounting-related activities, you know, such as bookkeeping, financial accounting, tax administration. And in some jurisdictions, these roles are regulated roles as well. ATs operate across all sectors. So they're working both in the private sector for large businesses, small business, but they're also working in the public sector as well. And they're working either for organisations, or many of them can also be self-employed and providing specific services to their own client base. And as we say before, they are recognised in some jurisdictions, and you'll hear from you know, two of the jurisdictions this afternoon, but they are also recognised in you know, places like South Africa, Sri Lanka, etc. So, but for the accounting technician, the recognition doesn't exist globally in the same way that there is recognition for the professional accountant. That term is, you know, globally recognised. So CPAs are recognised, chartered accountants are recognised. But in contrast, the term AT, accounting technician, only has that level of general level of recognition, obviously by the PAOs that have developed their qualifications in their jurisdictions, by IFAC, and also by many of the development partners as well. So going forward, as we continue with the development of this global goal and the outputs, one of the things that we will be talking about is, you know, achieving recognition requires many stakeholders to play their part. And that includes the yourselves as part of the panel, as part of IFAC's accountancy education. The task force contribution contributors, we have a number of people from not just the Asia Pacific area, but we also have people from members, representatives from the UK, and also from Africa as well. And there, the African involvement has been really key, because of some of the developments that are also happening in Africa as we speak. So based on the work to date and through the discussions that we're having, we've identified that there is actually a higher level of interest in accounting technicians by many PAOs, and also by IFAC more recently as well, through the development of the competence framework, for example. And we're grateful to have Bruce, who sits on the task force as well and provides fantastic input for us to really think about, and you know, often challenges us as well. And there are, you know, many reasons for ATs to be given more attention, and also many benefits that would accrue to many of the stakeholders. And we'll be outlining, we are actually starting to work on our output. We've got one or two more roundtables still to go. But we're starting to think about the output as well, and how we'll be how we'll lay out some of these benefits and the reasons why there should be more accounting technicians in the accounting profession. And you know, we've highlighted one of the benefits, and I suppose the duty that many PAOs have is around the public interest, and that the on the right hand side, that quote from IFAC's various publications is very apt in this particular instance. I'll leave you with this quote from one of the PAPA publications. Again, it's talking about the value that ATs can bring into the profession. And one of the things I'll just end with this is I'll say that the more we're thinking about digitalization and technology, the more we're thinking about sustainability, reporting and assurance, the more we're thinking about the wider economy, you know, the growth and development of our jurisdictions, then the more it makes sense for the profession to build the profession from the bottom up. And this requires all of us to play our part.